will just improve the accuracy of the calculation. So because this square and this cube are smaller and smaller numbers. But the problem is that these diagrams now start involving loops. And once they start involving loops, they actually go to infinity. So while they have e to the power 4 and e is a small number multiplying, when you do the calculation, they'll have some m where m goes to infinity. And these m's are the ones which you have to cancel. You know, that's called the renormalizable theory. And theories with symmetry, with more symmetry are renormalizable, and with less symmetry are not renormalizable. So the quantum electrodynamics has a symmetry. Now what symmetry does it have? Right, and this is also something that you can easily see. Quantum electrodynamics essentially has a rotation symmetry in this one plane. So basically what's happening is, you can think of it this way, when an electron is emitting a photon, that electron is like slightly rotating in some internal space, right? It's that photon makes it slightly rotate, right? And another electron absorbing in some internal space, it's absorbing. Now, it is just one photon. Only photon is the carrier of electromagnetic force because it's a rotation, right? And the symmetry, rotation symmetry means that the potential and stuff that you write will not depend on which way this electron is facing as it turns in this internal space. Yeah, I'll just come to your question in a second. Now, let's just think of that same rotation example. I just want you to understand for W plus, W minus and C naught, okay? Now, these are also very similar to electromagnetism, and I just want you to see the unity of thinking, right? Like you are explaining every force in the same way. Here, it's not rotation just in one dimension, in just one plane like this. But it's a rotation that can happen like in all the things. So which means that one particle is responsible for this rotation, one for that rotation, and so those are the W plus W minus and C naught. So that's a group called SU2 or O3. It's a rotation which is similar to O3. Mm-hmm. While this is a rotation in two-dimensional plane, which is a photon. So while there is only one carrier of electromagnetic force, because that involves a rotation symmetry in one plane, there are more carriers of the weak force because that involves a rotation symmetry in a higher dimensional plane. And these are internal spaces. But that rotational symmetry is what is important, right? So that those are called isosymmetries. Yeah. So what's your question?
I mean, I always thought that the directionality is like irrelevant, or there's no directionality in reality, right? I mean,
right.
So,
yeah.
I guess then what you're saying is that the electron in reality has a particular original direction every time it was born.
No. So the statement that it is symmetric means there is no direction. So any term that is picking a direction, you don't have it. So for example, like if supposing you're something has rotational symmetry, right? It won't have a term that depends on the angle, but it can still have a term that depends on the radius, because no matter how you rotate, the radius remains the same, right? So if you have some, but if you have things depending on the radius and the angle, like for example, the table is at this angle, while this table is fan is at this angle, there's no rotational symmetry, right? But at some radius, if I have something which doesn't depend on angle all around, then that has rotational symmetry. Right, so there are some terms that have rotational symmetry that you can have, which is what gives you these forces, but they are very, very reduced, right? And the number of rotational symmetries you can think about are also very finite, like rotation in one plane, rotation in three spaces, like that. Those are the internal things. And so these groups are called U1, which means rotation in essentially like one plane, SU2. So simple unitary group with two, which basically means this proton and neutron or up and down quarks can be written as a column vector for those who know about columns. And what this rotation operator is doing is a matrix. So a 2x2 matrix, that when you multiply a column vector with a 2x2 matrix, what you will find, so let's say that this has A minus A, and B star are the matrix element. So it's a traceless. Trace is the sum of the diagonal elements. So this is a traceless 2x2 matrix. and its Hermitian. So these are real. So for those who know a little bit of math, huh? So this is a real number. This is minus of that real number.
Yeah.
This is a complex number. Complex number is made of two real numbers. So and this is the star of that. So it's just so this. So totally, there are 3 degrees of freedom here. One real number A, and one complex number B, which is made of two real numbers. And this is the star of that. So there are 3 things. So these 3 numbers are what are giving you this W plus W minus and Z naught. And what is happening is the up and down quark. So if supposing you just had an up quark, it will be of this type. You multiply it by a matrix, then this column vector will change to like this. And when the entry is here, that becomes a down quark. So up can become a down quark. And the up and down quark, like you said, will be indistinguishable because of symmetry, right? You will not be able to make out. Like both will have exactly the same qualities. In fact, proton and neutron will exactly look the same. So this is the symmetry. Now, there is one problem with this theory. And that is that these terms, you know, that where infinities cancel and which are so beautiful and symmetric, imply that all masses should be equal to zero. Because any term that you put which can give a mass to that Z particle, actually W plus W minus and Z naught are heavy. I already told you, right? That's why we don't see them. Otherwise, there would be long range interactions. So they are heavy. But a mass term for these particles breaks the symmetry, which means the infinities don't cancel, which means we have a useless theory. So this is what we were stuck with. So we are stuck with a good theory, which seems to explain how up is changing to down and emitting this W plus W minus, but the theory necessarily has to have no mass for this W plus W minus and Z naught, which means it won't work unless the weak force is also long range force. So this is the problem that we have faced, okay? And that's where the LHC becomes important. But before that, I just want to also tell you, let's have a look at the structure of the atom here. So as far as the atom is concerned, you know, there's a nucleus, there's electrons going around the nucleus. Inside the nucleus, you have protons and neutrons. So protons actually are not elementary particles, but they are made of quarks. 2 ups and 1 down make a proton. 2 downs and 1 up make a neutron. Okay? So I just said you can think of the proton as up quark because there are more ups than downs in the proton. And you can think of the neutron as a down quark because there are more downs than ups in the neutron. Okay, so this is how our nucleus is, right? So essentially it has protons and neutrons, right? But all protons are positively charged. So what should happen? Like positive charges should repel, right? And the nucleus of an atom, if it has all protons, then it should repel. But so the atom should just split. So how is it that we have atoms? So that's the question, right? So what's holding the atoms together? So now the answer to that question is, of course, you might
internally.
What is that?
Internally, binding force, whatever.
Yeah, yeah. Binding force, because they are all positive charges, so
okay.
Actually they should just repel, right? So
okay.
There must be a greater attractive force,
okay,
that is keeping them together. So people, when they thought about the atomic structure, realized that our picture of forces with just electromagnetism and weak force, radioactivity, is incomplete. Because it doesn't explain why an atom's nucleus is being held together. So there must be one more force, which they have called the strong force. Because it is stronger than electromagnetism. Because it should be stronger than electromagnetism to hold the nucleus together.
Can I ask you one thing? Is there a debate about quarks being the foundational particles, the most elementary particles? Are quarks made of something else also? Is there a...
So that's a good question. Now, see, now the answers to a lot of questions of this kind are that we don't know whether electrons are more elementary or quarks are made up of more particles. Just as at some point we thought atoms were, you know, elementary, right? Now we know atoms are made up of other things. So in the same way, it's possible that quarks are made out of other things. It's possible electrons are made out of other things. And these then become theories of physics that you would... So essentially, if you collide quarks with greater than the energy with which, if they are made of something